Sis and tell. A whole lot of talk about a whole lot of nothing. Sis and tell. Amanda does stand up, and Allison on TV. Will they hop on the phone? Yeah, you know it's the place you wanna be. Sis and tell.
Hey, Allie.
Hey, man. What's going on?
I have to say, I've been feeling pretty popular the last week and a half, and it's because my Papa John's commercial is back on air.
I know. I saw it. I've been getting texts from friends who've seen it. Mazel tov.
I have learned a few things from this experience, and just to catch everyone up, last summer, our family was cast in a Papa John's commercial where we got to virtually be in the commercial with Shaquille O'Neal. Like, we talked to him through FaceTime.
You got to really FaceTime him, right?
Yes. Yeah. He was. And so there's some things that I've learned from this experience. And number one, we got a year's supply, quote unquote, of Papa John's pizza. And they essentially gave us a gift card equivalent of ordering one large pizza every week for a year.
I love that. That's like the bartering system. You do this for me and I'm going to give you something you need. I would totally work for food like that.
I really thought we could eat all this pizza, by the way. And maybe if we had had a party at the beginning, but it is so hard to eat all this pizza. And what makes it even more difficult is that the website has no idea that we've gotten this gift card. Doesn't matter. They just say every time you order, you also get reward points.
So you keep doubling. You're never getting rid of this card.
It is like, because I order pizza, I get more pizza. It is like a never-ending thing of pizza eating. And I said this when we first talked about this like a year ago. I saved this for the end, and I'm going to say it now. If you have a Papa John's in your neighborhood, that I will order you a large cheese or pepperoni pizza to be sent to you. All you have to do is tag Sis and Tell Podcast and then get five friends to also subscribe to us, and I'll send you a pizza.
Wait, okay? why are they limited to just cheese or pepperoni? Why are those the two limits?
Whatever they want. Just let me know your order. And Nancy Lim, she actually messaged me about this last year, and I was like, I will send you a pizza. And then she never sent me her when she wanted it. So Nancy,
we're going to give you the pizza.
Yeah, we'll still give you that pizza.
Hold on, we're going to trade pizza. Look at me, as if I have rights to the gift card. We're going to trade you pizza for Charlie videos. That's it. Yeah. That's our bartering system.
Incredibly adorable baby that we are obsessed with.
Yeah.
And I will actually bring you a pizza and my babysitting services. I will babysit that baby.
I will. I told Amanda if that baby is missing, don't come to my house. I will certainly have kidnapped her for a little bit.
I will come to your house because I would also like to be with that baby.
Yeah. My goal now is, I go down this rabbit hole. I have been during COVID of finding things that bring me joy. So one thing is my birthday's coming up, and I don't really like cake. I don't like icing really. I like some cake, but the icing's too sweet for me. So I usually do sort of like an apple pie. Mm. This year I've decided to do an ice cream cake. Ice cream cake is my other fallback. So Alan's like, well, what do you want? I said, I want a cake and I want the Despicable Me minions on top. He goes, are you five? I'm like, basically, because it's impossible for me to see a minion, like even the picture of one, much less like a GIF or a video, without hysterically laughing. So I just want them to bring me joy, which brings me back to Charlie. Like, this baby is the cutest, most precious thing. I could watch. I binge watch her videos. Nancy, I'm just admitting it. I binge watch it. And any other video. I go down that dodo. What is it? The dodo videos on Facebook.
Oh, yeah. It's like always like animals. Saving a dog.
Yeah, the save dogs.
Those make me cry, though.
Oh, yeah. The koala bears who are like stuck in Australia. They get stuck in a fence. They let them go. I mean, my gosh. It's amazing. So.
Oh, my gosh.
So, yeah. So back to the pizza. So what else have you learned?
That I'm super just like a positive person because when we met Shaq and I said something about as I usually do, I invite the most random people to our house. And I was like, come. I go, we live in Atlanta also. And he lives in McDonough, which is like, what, 25 minutes from me. And I was like, come stop by. And he's like, he took our address. Okay. He got our address. He asked for it. We gave it to him. And I was either expecting him to like send something, which I don't want anything. I just want Shaquille O'Neal.
Yeah.
And I was waiting. I keep on waiting for him to stop by, and I'm just waiting.
I mean, he may. You know, there's all these stories about him and paying it forward with kindness that he was in like a Best Buy or something and overheard a guy who needed a new computer and he just bought it for him.
Right.
He's a very kind, gentle giant.
That's what I am saying. That's what I'm saying, that I'm still waiting. He took my address. He's going to use it.
He's
going
to show up. Shaq is showing up.
And yeah. I'm like, we'll play a game of horse because I'm not good at basketball. I'm not even good at horse. Let's just, I'm the first one to get hoe.
There's a whole other line I could use after that. But why don't you just invite him in for pizza? That'd be great.
Yeah.
The good news is after a year of Papa John's Pizza, I think Weight Watchers is ready for you to star in their next ad.
Please cast me.
That's a lot of pizza. So I went down, speaking of rabbit holes online, I went down a rabbit hole that turned out really, really successful that I want to share. This is part of my PSAs of things that I have found that I'd like to share with everyone because of my altruism. Here's how it started. I'm looking at you. You're wearing this awesome coral colored shirt, which looks fabulous on you and also looks fabulous on mommy. And I would dare say if I ever wore coral, it would look fabulous on me. So mommy has this coral suit. She has a coral jacket, but she also has this lavender suit that she wears. And I thought
I thought it was pink. Is it lavender?
Maybe it's pink. Pink or lavender, but it's like a full, pantsuit.
Yes, I love it.
And I love it too. And all of a sudden I was in Birmingham a couple of weeks ago and I was looking in her closet because it's like the Holy Grail. I'm like, what's in here? She goes, you can have anything. So besides the fact that I'm 3 or 4 inches taller than she is. So, so I'm like looking and I was like, God, I've got to get a suit like this. I need some color. So I thought she had told me she got the suit at TJ Maxx, which her TJ Maxx, if anybody shops at TJ Maxx, all TJ Maxx's are not equal.
No, we've got a runway TJ Maxx.
Okay, and this is what I'm talking about. Yeah, okay, tell us about, what does that mean, runway?
It means like, usually at my Marshalls, I can get things for $1,500. I mean, $15 and it's a deal. But at the TJ Maxx runway, they have high-end couture that's discounted, but it's still like $1,500.
Yeah.
I mean, it's expensive, but like instead of you paying, $3,000, like, yes, we'll give this to you for $1,500. I'm like, oh, thank you.
Exactly.
But they have really nice stuff. And if you're already like someone who has the budget for that, then I would go to TJ Maxx Runway. But it's a special TJ Maxx. It's not all TJ Maxx's, as you said.
Yes. So I went on the TJ Maxx website to try to find a suit. And then I saw that little button flashing at me at the top that is the Runway. And I had no idea that you can access Runway clothes online. Oh. On tjmaxx.com. Isn't
nice.
This exciting?
And then you can return it to the TJ Maxx.
And you have 40 days to return it to any TJ Maxx store. So I thought, well, there's no harm, no foul, because I really like shopping in person. I like the brick and mortar, but the TJ Maxx runway option is not an option. There are no runway stores in Chattanooga. So I thought, I'm not like going online instead of, I'm going because it's my only access point. I started going down. I started looking for the lavender suit, which apparently she actually did not buy from TJ Maxx, or the pink suit. But the finds on TJ Maxx runway are incredible. And to your point,
some of
it's not like they're selling, Givenchy or all these couture things like Chanel for
$10. That how you pronounce that? That's how you pronounce that?
I don't know. Givenchy?
Yeah. I'll say Givenchy.
Givenchy? yes. There's a city in Georgia called Lafayette, which they have no idea. It's Lafayette. Yes.
Lafayette.
Don't tell them. It'll bust their bubble. Yeah, Ponce de Leon. So it has got all of these things. And sometimes it'll say, it'll show you like a pair of jeans or a shirt. And then it won't even show you the designer, and it'll say, reveal designer. So then it's like a game show. I was like, ooh, who do I think it is? And they have like Zadig and Voltaire like jackets. They have Alice and Olivia stuff. They have, it's unbelievable.
You're naming brands that I just have never heard of.
Yeah, and I'm not a big brand person, but I know some of these are very high end. And what I started doing is I'd look on the site, and then I would go onto a regular website and see how much it really was. Ooh. Because TJ Maxx undersells. They're lowballing even the retail price. Like they'll say this jacket's $125, but it retails for $200. Oh no, some of these jackets retailed for $550. And the real things like these shoes and these bags that you're talking about, they were, I mean, expensive. This was not cheap. They're like $1,500, $850. I wasn't buying that stuff, but I got so many great things. I got a pair of like amazing jeans for like $75, which I know is still expensive, but like regularly priced like $400. A jumpsuit, regularly priced like $1,600, I got for $200. I mean, I'm telling you, this was like the most fun. This was like a virtual Canal Street, except the purses are not fakes. That's the best way I can describe it. And it was so much fun to shop because I'm not spending that much money in real life. I'm just not buying couture. Where am I going to wear the couture? But if I can get it for inexpensive and have a statement piece or something for black tie in my closet that I'm always like, I could use that, then I did. And it was very fun.
I'm always wishing I had some place to wear things to. And we had a bat mitzvah to go to last weekend. And I was so excited because I had three events in one day to wear things to.
So many change options.
I was like, I'm going to have wardrobe changes. It's like, it was like an award show. We are renting that place for Thanksgiving for the whole family. And I think that we should have a dress up day. I would like to just sit around in a cocktail dress all day drinking beer.
See, that's the difference. I have no desire to dress up, but I would like to own 45 pairs of jeans and some really great flip-flops and make that my wardrobe for nearly 90% of my life.
It'll just be a wear what you want day. So I might be in my banana costume or I might
I'm going to have to put a hard no on the banana costume at Thanksgiving.
Why?
Oh, Amanda, come on.
Come on what? My kids love it. I'm sorry. I know you're embarrassed by it, but my kids love that banana costume.
I don't think embarrassed encapsulates my feelings very well.
How are my 15-year-old is not embarrassed of me in that banana costume, and you are?
No, I'm saying I'm not embarrassed.
Beyond embarrassed.
It's not embarrassed. It's
the word in the English language does not exist, but it probably does in German somewhere.
It's like a combination of annoyed and frustrated. Is that unustrated?
Can't believe we're related. What is that in German?
Gosh,
there's got to be some like word.
There's got to be some word that exists. All right. So my other shopping excitement, which I haven't been there yet, but Daddy is very excited about, is right over the border. So I live in Chattanooga and we are 2 minutes
lottery
from the
tickets.
not lottery tickets. No, he is excited about those too, but we're right over the, 2 miles from the border of Alabama and Georgia, and right over the border of Georgia, maybe not right over the border, probably
fireworks.
30 minutes from the border is let's see if you know this. This is Daddy's new favorite store. It is technically a C store, a convenience store, but it is a C store on steroids.
Oh, I don't know. Quick Trip has got is pretty amazing.
No.
They should see their food. I would eat there.
Okay. I don't know if you've heard of this, but it's called Bucky's.
Stucky's?
No. Not Stucky's. Bucky's. B-U-C-E-E-E-E-S. I put too many E's. Yeah, just keep putting E's and then throw an S on the end.
I have heard of Bucky's, but I don't know what Bucky's is.
Okay. So Bucky's is, it's just that it's a convenience store basically on steroids. And they built this one like somewhere in Georgia. Maybe it's even 30 minutes from here. So it's not right over the border. But on the news, this is what they said. 53,000 square feet.
No.
Yes. And guess how many gas pumps?
100.
120 gas pumps. Yeah.
No.
Yes.
That place sounds very flammable.
Oh, Well, yeah, when they say that place is on fire, that's not maybe a good thing.
God, that's giving Stuckey's run for its money.
Stuckey's got nothing on Bucky's. But Daddy acts like, I mean, it's hysterical. He stopped at one and he couldn't stop talking about it. And Mommy kept going, it's a convenience store. Like, it's literally a gas station, but it's just really big. But he's like, oh, no. It's much better. It is much better.
Mall. That is a mini mall.
Yeah. It's like Sam's Club and Exxon merged and had a baby. And this is
what else do they have? Why would they possibly need 50,000 square feet of convenience store?
I don't know.
It's a department store at that point.
Yeah. 53,000 square feet. What is in there?
You could probably shower in there if I had to guess. Like, think of like a truck stop. There's probably a restaurant. There's probably like a little bodega.
I think they're like trying to be sort of the convenience, the target of convenience stores, right? So it's probably higher end pork rinds.
Why would you name it Bucky's though?
You know, a larger selection of corn nuts.
Missed opportunity for Stuckey's, I have to say.
Well, people who are listening who have been in Bucky's are I'm sure going to give us some feedback on what to do. Similar to my post about Trader Joe's, I have gotten, I swear, so many comments of people wanting to give me feedback. And I appreciate it all. I do.
You know what Bucky sounds like? The TJ Maxx runway store of convenience stores.
It is. I'm not sure if it's necessarily the runway, but it's close.
You said it's higher end. Convenience store products.
I don't know if it's higher end because I've never been there.
Just told me. You just said their pork rinds are.
That's what I'm guessing. I'm guessing.
Are like artisanal.
Yeah.
They're small batch artisanal corn nuts.
Wouldn't that be amazing?
We make them right in front of you, which we flavor them on the spot.
Our nuts are especially corny.
Right.
So I got to go to a Bucky's. We've been watching it. It's between here and Atlanta, so we could meet there. We could meet there, and we could do.
Yes.
We could do a live podcast from Bucky's.
Mm-hmm. We're doing that. I'm totally going to Bucky's. I cannot wait. I love stores like that. Okay. I hate shopping, but I want to be at Bucky's. So I have to say that I recently got a sponsored post from TJ Maxx. Speaking of TJ Maxx, bringing us back to there. And is Mindy Kaling from The Office was on there.
I don't think that's her last name. I think it's Kaling, right?
Kaling.
Or Kaling. Yeah, I don't think it's Kaling. That doesn't sound right. I feel like you left out a letter. I added too many E's to Bucky's, and you totally truncated Mindy's name.
Yes, I do.
I think it's Mindy Kaling.
Kaling. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, thanks.
You know, her real name is Vera Mindy Chocolingam. Okay. If I'm pronouncing that totally.
Well, then her name was already shortened, but that was her choice, not yours.
Like John Stamos, his name is shortened. Anyways, Mindy, I'm embarrassed.
It's okay.
Kaling, Kaling.
Sure.
Okay. I am known to like not pronounce anyone's name correctly. I'm lucky I can pronounce my own name. So anyway, she's on there, and TJ Maxx is doing this initiative that has nothing to do with clothes, and it's one of my favorite hobbies, and it's pen palling. And you can enter your information on their site, and they will set you up with a pen pal. And I did it, and I have to wait 1 to 2 weeks for them to make a match. And it is like online dating, but for pen pals. And I'm so excited, and I can't wait to report back on it.
Okay, wait, let's back up. Why is TJ Maxx getting into the pen pal business? That feels very, very out of their wheelhouse. What is the benefit to them of hooking you up with somebody in the world to write to?
I don't know, but it's not a business. They're just doing it as a service. They're not making money.
But why? Why would you utilize resources? Retail is struggling enough. Why would you decide that is the weirdest offshoot of any retail mission I've ever heard?
I don't know.
Who sat around and said, you know what? For the good of humanity, let's set up a system where we can assign people pen pals. I think they're going to really embrace that.
You know what? They also kind of tease, and they're like, maybe you never know who your pen pal is going to be. Like, it could be Mindy. Like, it's not going to be Mindy. I know it's not going to be Mindy, but what if it is? What if my pen pal, what if they're like, the first 100 people, we're going to then pick a name out of a hat, and that person gets to be Mindy's pen pal.
Well, and is it really a pen pal, or is it going to be an e-pal?
So you got to choose between handwritten letters and emails, and I have terrible handwriting, and I'm also really impatient, so I chose email.
So basically, TJ Maxx has scammed you into receiving more emails from people you don't know, which is basically spam.
No!
Yeah, that is technically the definition of that. Receiving emails in your inbox from people you don't know. You can opt out and opt in of spam, I'm just saying. You're getting things...
No, it's spam. You did not opt into it. Okay. I opted into it, and it's one-on-one, very customized email to me where we share our feelings and our favorite finds on TJ Maxx.
I have a feeling it's going to be Janice from store 132 who's going to say, Amanda, can I get you a TJ Maxx card so you can save 10% on this purchase today? And you're going to say, no, Janice, but how was your barbecue last weekend? Janice doesn't care to share her barbecue information.
Not even her recipe. I'm like, I'm sorry, Janice. I don't want your potato salad recipe. And I don't want a TJ Maxx Sonista credit card either. I just want the rewards program. I don't want the credit card.
I cannot wait to see how this unfolds. This is the weirdest. That is the weirdest offering.
What?
Now, I don't think being a pen pal is weird. I think the fact that TJ Maxx is the one ushering this is really a disconnect for me. I'm sorry.
They're trying to build a lifestyle brand.
Okay, well, let's get off that topic. Speaking of trends, like TJ Maxx trends, I want to get back to my favorite show on the face of the planet, and you know what it is.
Ted Lasso!
I love Ted Lasso. Speaking of bringing me joy, right? This is everything I watch now has to bring me some sort of joy. Ted Lasso brings me so much joy that I'm rewatching Ted Lasso, and here's what I discovered. And I discovered two things in this discovery. One, Alan and I figured out that it's so much better watching Ted Lasso with subtitles on. Because even though it's in English, it's British English, most of it.
Yeah, and, I miss things. Yeah.
And it's so quick, the wit on the show, the writing is so quick that I didn't even realize how much of the American English I was missing, or even the inside jokes or the subtle jokes. So the last few episodes, we started rewatching and putting on subtitles. It is life-changing. So then my friend Valerie puts on there, right? I don't know why I'm late to the party, but Ted Lasso is amazing. And I wrote on there, oh, watch it with subtitles. It's even better. Everybody started commenting after me. Oh, yeah, we watch every show with subtitles. What are you talking about?
Okay, we do too.
How did I not know this was a thing?
I don't know if it's a thing when you get old. But I have a really, I get more, right, I don't miss as many things. Also, my children are constantly like interrupting, or there's noise. We have dogs, and I love the subtitles.
Yeah.
I need them. I've gotten so used to them. I watch everything with subtitles now.
Well, now I have to try.
So, yeah. But also, you know that there has been some recent backlash against Ted Lasso.
What?
People were complaining. Wait for it.
That he's too happy?
Too positive.
No.
Right?
Okay, those people.
But then other people were like, well, screw that.
Yeah.
You know? Like, who cares? And, you know, something happened in the last episode that kind of brought things to not everything is perfect, and people are now happy again. But here's one thing, and for those of you who don't listen, who haven't watched it, just pause this and go binge first season and most of second season at this point. Just stop listening to us and start listening to Ted.
Exactly.
But the one thing that I can't quite wrap my head around, which feels very off-brand for Ted's character, is that he would leave his son in the United States to take this job in London. It doesn't make sense to me, right? And it wasn't like this was a one-month thing. He's been there now through Christmas, right? The fact that he has not gone back to the United States, and I know he had some stuff going on with his wife, but it doesn't make any sense to me.
Yeah.
It seems, and I feel like they're going to reveal why he would do that, because it's too big of a disconnect for his character to be that far away from his son.
Do you think, though, it's just wasn't shown, but that maybe he did go back and forth to see his son and we don't know about it?
No, because they haven't. They would talk about it. They would mention it.
Yeah, you're right. Now I'm upset. Now I'm upset. Not because he's too positive, but because why isn't he seeing his son? I think when he first went to London, he thought that the separation with his wife might have been just temporary and she needed some space. And then I think it grew. I think this is why, and spoiler alert if you haven't watched the show at all, so you can stop listening to us for a second. But this last episode that aired was about, I think, him coming to terms with what you're talking about. I think we're going to find out this week how that plays out.
There was some trauma. Yeah, there was some trauma.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I don't know if that has anything to do with his son, but I just don't know how any parent can be that far away from their child, and especially one that has been painted into perfection.
Especially Ted. Right? Especially
Ted. Especially Ted, because he's so fatherly. He's so loving. He's so giving of himself and of his time. He does special things for everyone, and he's still like connected with his kid virtually, and you see that he's such a good
dad.
Talking
about him like he's real.
Yeah, but he is real to me.
Look, I love Jason Sudeikis. I love his character. I love Ted. But my favorite character is Roy Kent. He is like the real life version of the Minions to me. He, every time he talks, I laugh hysterically. And do you know his backstory in real life?
I love that you compare him to the Minions because he's so grumpy.
he's so grumpy, but his noises that he makes, I mean, he's like,
Yeah, he grunts. He growls.
So I went down a little, you know, media rabbit hole with him last week because a bunch of people were posting about his backstory, which is he is a writer on the show. And he talked about his name. Do you know his name in real life?
No.
Brett Goldstein. He's a Goldstein.
No, wait. Brett Goldstein?
Yes.
Are you kidding me?
Yes.
He could be our cousin. Yes. We have cousins in England, but not on that side. Oh my gosh, he's a Goldstein, but he looks very Sephardic.
He does. He does. So we have to figure out, yeah, but Goldstein's not Sephardic.
It's not, no.
Okay, so he's a writer on the show, and he says by the time he's at like episode 4 or 5 of the first season, he thinks in his head, I could play Roy Kent. Like, I get who this character is supposed to be. I understand how he's supposed to act. I could play this character. But he also didn't want to tell anybody on the staff or the producers or the writing room because he thought, how awkward is it if I'm like, hey, I could be Roy Kent? And they're like, yeah, we don't think so. And then he had to keep writing the rest of the first season and beyond. So as soon as they finished with the first season, they completed writing it. He had already pre-taped 5 episodes of him. Not 5 episodes, but 5 scenes from the first season where Roy Kent was, one of the leads. And then he emailed it to the producers. And he said, look, this whole season I've been thinking in my head, I could be Roy Kent. Here's my audition tape. If you think it's trash, let's pretend I never emailed this and just ignore it. But if you think it's a possibility, let's talk. And the rest is history. And he is
perfect.
Roy Kent. Oh my gosh.
But they all must have some soccer chops, right? Because they're all extremely athletic and really good at soccer, at least according to the editing that's done.
Right. Yeah. I mean, the actors who play the soccer players, they've got to have some background. They just look too good, or else maybe the editing does make them look good. But I love Roy Kent. I love him. I just love everything. Oh my gosh. He is so funny. And I love that backstory and that he could be related.
Even the cursing though, because I know you have.
Oh, I don't have a problem with cursing. Alan does, but Alan's fine with it. So I'm fine with it. Yeah. He does curse a lot. He drops a lot of bombs, but on TV, I'm fine with it. It's if my kids are cursing that much. Then I have an issue. Yeah.
Okay. Yes. I get it.
So anyway, anybody who has not watched Ted Lasso, we might have ruined the entire show for you.
We basically went up to the last episode we've seen.
I feel like this
season.
Is my gift to people, though. If you haven't seen it or started it and you've been like, oh, I've heard about it. No, just stop everything you are doing. Go home from work. Like, put the kids in a playpen, if those even exist.
Playpen. Baby jail.
Yes. I mean, just go and start binge watching it. It will be worth your while. And turn on the subtitles.
Yeah, I have an idea for a new feature, okay? And it's that, and fans, listeners, who may not be fans, but just listening and hating us, tell me what you think of this feature, and I have an ulterior motive, and it's that we have a segment where we interview a Goldstein. Any Goldstein will do. Not any Goldstein will do. We find the Goldsteins. And because, you know, we're Goldsteins. And really, it's just so we can talk to Brett Goldstein. That is my ultimate goal.
We're getting Brett Goldstein. I'm going to get him on the show.
Let's get Brett Goldstein on the show.
We are getting Brett Goldstein on the show. All right.
Yes.
Forget Courtney Cox. We're after Brett Goldstein. Ready?
Oh, that was good.
Thanks.
Allison.
Thanks.
That's why you're in alto too.
There you go. There you go.
Well, thanks for listening to the latest Sis and Tell podcast. Share us with your friends. Share us with your enemies.
As always, this has been Amanda and Allison with a whole lot of talk about a whole lot of nothing. We'll catch you next time.